And we've got Jay McKenna in the studio and Joe Blott, both from the Spirit of Shankly organisation. Gents, thank you for your time. Thanks for coming in today. Mental health is very much on the agenda for a number of different reasons. What with it being World Mental Health Day on Wednesday? And Jay, you and I have spoken about your own mental health in the past as well. And is it fair to say that you're aware as much as anybody that actually the match-going fella in particular, a difficult sort of section of society to target when it comes to getting the right messages out there in regard to mental health?
I think it is because, you know, one of the problems we know exists is that men don't talk about it and men suffer from this and it's almost hidden. And football, rightly or wrongly, wrongly in my opinion, is seen as macho. And, you know, the players are always having this thing of toughen up and, you know, man up kind of thing. Fans go there and, you know, it's almost tribal, isn't it? And you've got to, you know, be on display and, you know, shouting and screaming for your team. And I think it's just also an environment in which you actually go and just do something fun. You actually go and enjoy yourself. So, you know, I've mentioned this and I know Dave Downey has when he's talked about things, you know, the match is probably a bit of an outlet for you, really. It's 90 minutes where you're not thinking about, you know, whatever's in your mind. It does distract you really nice. It's when you come home after it. And I think, you know, it's problematic in that sense because it's not always easy to spot signs or get people to talk about it. But equally, it presents an opportunity. It's a time when you are around, you know, usually, you know, men, mates, and you can talk about it. And, you know, you have lots of chats, no doubt about whether it should be, you know, Trent Alexander-Arnold or Joe Gomez playing right back on whether Man City, you know, did or didn't deserve a pen. You'd have all them conversations, you know, and there's probably a space and time, only a few minutes, where you can just have that opportunity at half time or before the game, having a pint to say to someone, you know, how you're feeling, are you okay kind of thing. And I think it presents us that opportunity, which, you know, some of the stuff you'll touch on is what we've tried to do with Spirit and that others are doing with us, to use it as a catalyst for positive change.
Absolutely. I think the answers to those two questions are, they thought Leroy Sané was playing, and yes.
Yeah.
Let's bring Joe unfair, into the conversation. Joe Blott. Joe, thank you for coming in as well. People, Liverpool fans who subscribe to LFC TV will be able to see a documentary later on this week, which is
not just those who subscribe. It's going to be free for everybody.
Free to everybody. Sorry. Brilliant stuff. The club are... Liverpool Football Club, you know, they're not a mental health organisation, but they have almost a duty of care, if you like, to sort of to do things like this. So it's brilliant that actually this documentary is going to be going out later on this week, which will look at the issue of mental health, but frame it within a footballing context. And I sometimes think, Joe, that it's okay to trick people into watching something about mental health, because actually in going, this is about mental health, but it's okay because it's football, people will then realise that this is actually... it's about everything. It's about themselves. It's about their mates. It's about their dads, their brothers, their mums, male or female, which is why this is such a commendable programme that's been put together.
Yeah, you're so right. I mean, it's brilliantly put together as well. And I think when we began the conversations with the club and then LFC TV, clearly they were looking at it from purely a football perspective, really, and a footballer perspective. You know, clearly it tells the story of Jason McAteer. The troubles that he had, he's been through, he wants to share those experiences, and that's fantastic to do that. I think the conversations we were having was how do you broaden that out to say there's kind of a level playing field here? You know, it can happen to anybody, as you've just been discussing. How can we get a fan experience? How can we get a broader experience? World Mental Health Day plays a big part in that, really, because this year's theme is the impact of modern world on young people. So you think about the academy now and the young people and what's happening there. You know, there's young kids being picked up at 7, 8, and 9, staying with the club for a good few years, going through their young teenage years, and then maybe being rejected, maybe being supported all the way through that. So you're right, that duty of care that the club has, they've really, really gone to town on that and making sure that young people have that follow through and support all the way through. And they've got counsellors, they've got support, they've got therapists, they're linked into the CAMS network, etc. Beyond that, it's been then, well, what does the fan take of this? And as you know, Jay's just been alluded to, we've got, you know, 54,000 people turn up, hopefully for a well-being experience at a match on a Saturday or whenever it's played. But at the same time, there's 7 days in between where life struggles get there. So how do we support that? And that's where, you know, talking to your mates, having your mates. But I think the real powerful bit is about the impact of mental health and mental well-being. And clearly, you know, this, the film, the documentary, I think draws attention to not just the footballing aspect, but just how the impact can be felt. And that's where we see that the fan story come through in terms of the impact being, unfortunately, with the tragic loss of life and the impact that has on a family, the impact that has on a football community. And all credit to Liverpool Football Club for taking that responsibility as well, in terms of their not only their employment responsibility, but their social responsibilities as well.
I guess as well, you know, that football fans, you know, of a certain mindset go into a game, great because you're there to go and enjoy a game or do the as Jay said, you know, the stand up and beat your chest and so on and so forth. But I think it's really wrong to assume that football fans don't have the capacity to understand this stuff. You know, when football fans have the capacity to understand that a player's not making, you know, tracking runs because he's fourth metatarsal got broken, it was only 8 weeks from his operation and it's a 10-week recovery period. Football fans have that knowledge already. Mm. And yet the idea that you would then turn to your mate and go, and how are you feeling today? But how are you really feeling? Yeah. They're not going to want to do it. They can do that. We've got the capacity to do it.
We can. And I think that's the message we're trying to get out here. It is raising awareness here. And I know there's a big conversation about, well, when you've asked that first question and your mate says, well, I'm actually not feeling too good today, what's your next point? Well, that's where we're trying to say is, well, actually, it's a conversation now, because your mate will actually appreciate perhaps having a conversation, a chance to talk, an opportunity just to vent the feelings, just to say, can you just keep in touch with me during the week? Can I ring you when I'm feeling a bit low? Not to solve. There's professional organisations there to solve, and we can you know, direct people. That's what the film does at the end. Clearly gives in its credit to know who people can contact. I think that conversation bit is about exploring and preventing. And, you know, we've seen the figures, haven't we? You know, 64 young men take their lives every week. You think, you extrapolate that to a football stadium, that means that in 14 years' time, Anfield will be empty. That's just like phenomenal to think that, you know, society kind of allows that to happen. If we can make any impact through football fans, you know, who really are, you know, sort of right across the spectrum of the social stratosphere of the country, then I think that's the message we're trying to give out.
Yeah, there is some sort of mind-blowing sort of ways of thinking about, you know, often the one that always strikes me is, Jay, that idea that of all the things that you might face in your life, the thing that's most likely to kill you is yourself.
Yeah.
As a man, between that particular age bracket, particularly 25 to 44, you are the biggest threat to yourself.
Yourself, yeah.
Which is a frightening thing to think about, really. But football can be a part of it. Football can be that connection, can't it?
Yeah, it's the commonality between people, isn't it? And it's what will bind you, so it gives you reason to talk to others and stuff like that. But, you know, in the documentary, and it is worth watching, and it is a hard watch in part. It talks about Neil Hughes, a Liverpool supporter who killed himself, and you see firsthand the impact it has on his dad and one of his mates who had saw him. But you can see within that, you know, that they weren't aware. They didn't know. And, you know, you see the hate that they, you know, feel because they wanted to have been there. And I think, you know, if we can help, that someone might be able to say, you know what, I can speak to my mum and dad and I can ask a mate, or I can ring an organisation, or I can contact someone and say, you know, you've wrote about this, can you tell me what I need to do to go and speak to someone? If this documentary just helps one person like that and means that they maybe reconsider whether, you know, taking their life is what they want to do or feel they need to do, you know, then it's certainly worthwhile. But if it just gets us talking just about how you feel, you know, mental health isn't just about suicide, it is just about how you feel and how you're coping. You know, if we can get to a place where people just feel, you know, it's automatic that as well as asking who's playing, that, you know, when you ask a mate, you know, and I've said this on when we've done the mental health marathon on here, and it's, I think it's one of the themes within mental health first aid, isn't it? Is ask twice. You know, you say to someone how you feel, oh, I'm okay. Ask again, you know, are you really okay? If you know they're not, if you know they're quiet as usual, you need being quiet. Ask about work, ask about family, ask something else, follow it up to make sure that they know you're there and just try and see. And it might be that they just never will. Some people just never will open up, but the person will know they're there. That you're willing and wanting to talk to them about. And I think, you know, one of the themes that comes through in the documentary is that feeling of people wanting direction, wanting support. They want something they know inside themselves. Jason McAteer talked about this. And, you know, my experience I was watching it and I was thinking, so many similarities there. I was like, you always doubt yourself, even after your experience of it, you always doubt yourself. I was thinking, oh my God, no, these are just similarities across people within this. They're just wanting someone to help them, but they just can't articulate what they want them to help them with and why. So having someone who's willing to just help you pry open that box might just be a good thing. And I think, you know, the documentary does that. And, you know, the idea that we're having, you know, World Mental Health Day and that we're having conversations like this might just mean someone who's listening to this just thinks, oh no, you know, I should talk to someone. And if it helps bit by bit like that, then, you know, it slows down, you know, that rate of death that you and Joe mentioned.
We got Jay McKenna and Joe Blott from Spirit of Shankly on the show. They're working alongside the World Mental Health Day, which is coming up on Wednesday, alongside the Liverpool Mental Health Festival, which is ongoing as well. And they've also keen to sort of promote the issue of mental health and well-being among football fans in the light of a documentary which is set to appear on LFC TV on Wednesday. I'm sure there'll be plenty of repeats of it as well. Joe, let me get this right. So the documentary, I mean, the headline act, if you like, is Jason McAteer, who was part of his autobiography, talked about mental health concerns that he had and issues that he faced within the game as well. You don't have to look too far outside of the LFC family, even outside of the dressing room, to find that there are many other players who've had similar types of experiences to Jason McAteer, and that's included within the documentary.
It is, yeah. I mean, there's reference to that in terms of former Liverpool players. So Chris Kirkland speaks really powerfully about his experience of that. But clearly, we've had in the recent past, there've been a number of footballers, haven't there? Been a number of high profile celebrities as well who've actually begun to voice their own experience of mental well-being and the ill health that they've suffered as a consequence of where they've been in their life. I think it's that opportunity that people have come out. I think mental health, you know, for many, many years has had a stigma attached to it now. And I think what we're trying to do is peel the paper back on that and say it's actually okay to recognise that you're having these low times, and there's people there who can help, and hopefully it's your friends who can help, it's the organisation who can help. You were referring to before about the, you know, the way that Liverpool are taking mental health seriously within their organisation and now broader. That's something that I think we see as a massive positive. And I think, you know, part of the festival this week, really, I can't imagine sort of 10 years ago a mental health festival being so sort of avant-garde in the way that this is. You know, this is about celebrations through film, through drama, through comedy, through ordinary life, that people have suffered mental ill health and mental well-being. But actually, you know, that's okay. It's all right. And the people who are doing it, they're high-profile musicians. They are people who you'd expect, but they can't have mental health problems because they have a sort of a privileged, in inverted commas, life. So they should be okay, shouldn't they? But it's not. It covers everybody.
Well, you mentioned Chris Kirkland, who was kind enough to appear on the programme. That podcast, by the way, I think is still available, Mental Health Monday, if you want to search for that one. Stan Collymore came on as well. Now, Stan Collymore, people forget how good Stan Collymore was as a footballer, and Liverpool paid a world record fee at the time? £8.5 million,
the British
record fee, for a player who had everything.
Yeah,
everything that you could get in here. But when people would ultimately look back, and outside of a couple of games, Newcastle being one of them, we kind of go, well, what really happened there? What was the point in all that? You then speak to Stan Collymore, and then you go, all right, that now makes sense. Yeah. He had problems through Liverpool. He moved to Aston Villa thinking, I'll go home, that'll be easier. Mm-hmm. Then had issues with the manager at the time, to the point where he's saying, you need to get me out of this team, I can't play football anymore. And he's got the senior pros giving him, you know, dog's abuse, because who do you think you are? You know, you've been one of these Spice Boys, now you think this, that and the other. The manager's calling him out in the press. Gareth Southgate, I think, was one of the senior players at the time, and he's going, what are you doing? And Stan Collymore, what he said on the program, he said to me, he said, I spoke to Gareth Southgate years later. Gareth Southgate said, if I knew then what I know now, of course we would have dealt with that situation completely differently. You know, for him, it was him and Hugo Ekiog and Andy Townsend all sort of going, right, we're going to get this lad to pull himself together a little bit. And actually, you look at that and you think, well, actually, that can replicate itself right across all kinds of sports. And then transfer itself into your own workplace. Where the lad used to always be in the pub, he's not here anymore. He used to always be one of the first on, you know, the team sheet when you'd be playing five-a-side. He doesn't come anymore. Yeah. And those sorts of things you can spot. And I think some people are really learning the lessons and other people aren't. I was really warmed when I saw Brighton and Hove Albion. I've done an interview with Anthony Knockhart, and he talked about a situation he had within his family. And he spoke to Chris Hughton. Chris Hughton said, as the manager of Brighton and Hove Albion, you don't have a choice on this. We're going to get you some help.
Yeah.
And I thought, what a great attitude that is.
Yeah. You've that moved actually, that decision for the yeah, person and you're just going to make sure they get the support.
You've gone, that's not a problem. I've got the solution for you and I'm going to, you know, guide you to that, yeah, that solution as well. Jane, from a union point of view on this one as well, these are employees as well, yeah, and employers. And there is a duty of care for employers. You know, if it was a building site, you'd say, make sure you're wearing a hard hat.
Yeah.
But would you ever say, you know, did you have suicidal thoughts before you came into work this morning?
Yeah, and I think what we've got to try and do is normalise that discussion, not just amongst mates, but in workplaces. You know, that if I walked in with a limp, they would ask me, is everything okay? If I, you know, fell and broke my leg, they wouldn't assume that, you know, I was weaker than the person who fell and didn't break the leg. So why would we assume, you know, there's a problem with someone if they're experiencing mental ill health and somebody else isn't? So I think we've got to normalise that. And I think if we can get to a point where the idea of just talking about how you feel, whether that's good and bad, we get to a place where it's easier to talk about being bad because you talk about being good. Most people, you know, myself, in my experience, you know, I always thought I felt good. And then I felt not good. But there was no place to go and talk about how I feel because there was no place to ever talk about how I felt before this. So how do we do that? And, you know, one of the things that's, again, in the documentary is early, because, you know, the club have a psychologist that talks to, you know, players. And I think and this is where football has got the power of change. We will look in our workplace and say, you know, why would we need one of them? Because I just do this job. And then it's like, well, a footballer has it. Oh, well, if a footballer has it, it's good enough for them. It's good enough for us, isn't it? You know, people follow diets because athletes now follow these diets. And like, well, if it's good enough for him, it's good enough for me. And now, if X player, you know, can go and sit in a room in Melwood and just talk about how they're feeling and that they've got these stresses at home. Well, maybe them stresses at home that I've got, you know, that won't go away, maybe need talking about. And I think if we can get to that point, it normalises it. Obviously, the big elephant in the room on this is funding and support. But not all of this needs, you know, psychologists and counsellors in workplaces. It just needs people to be signposted to the right place, but also just an environment that someone thinks, if I'm not feeling myself and it's affecting how I do my job, it's affecting how I feel when I just come to work, we need to talk about it. It is a workplace issue then, because otherwise what happens is the person comes in and they're a bit quieter. You know, they're not as chatty as normal. Oh, isn't he a grump? You know, that kind of language becomes, not always a grump, and the person goes within themselves. They don't want to talk. People think they're just grouchy and that they're miserable. Well, oh, they're just like that. They don't really talk. They don't really socialise. I mean, they become the problem instead of us dealing with the problem, which isn't the person. It's just something they're experiencing. And I think if we can get to that point where we normalise how we are and how we feel about things, you know, we might also just be a bit more considerate that, you know, you see lots of this, don't you? People saying to, you know, usually around women, you know, you say, oh, smile, love. It's like, no, you don't need to say that. Have a thought about why the person might be feeling the way they do, or that they just don't smile. But if that's someone in the workplace, go and talk to them. Go and ask them, is everything okay? You know, it might just be that they've just had a bad day. It might be they had no sleep, the kids were up all night kind of thing. Or it might be that they're experiencing a problem and they just need someone to talk. But you know, passing off a glib comment or making an assumption of them isn't going to work. So, you know, we spend most of our time at work. We are in work for a significant portion of our lives. We should use that time to make sure that, you know, people's well-being is good. It shouldn't just be a thing you have to talk about at the match on a Saturday or, you know, when you're going to your family.
Yeah, and I think just in terms of, you know, the Spirit of Shankly, it's union responsibilities. I mean, clearly, you know, our members aren't our employees. So it's a very different sort of engagement that we have. The thing that binds us together, the Spirit of Shankly, Liverpool Football Club, and our membership is football. And that's what we were thinking about. Well, how do we join that together? What is it that is so important to us that we can do something about this in terms of campaigning? And we just felt that there was a social responsibility that we had as a union, as a mature union, to work with the club. We do a lot of lobbying on behalf of our members in terms of sometimes, you know, unfortunately, a negative way with the club, but actually, you know, there's positive ways of working as well. And I think that's what we've got here. We've got a positive outcome by working together, by us joining up with Liverpool Mental Health Consortium, working through Liverpool Public Health in terms of the work that they've done, Paul's Place, Beacon Counselling. You know, we kind of, you know, got ourselves really heavily involved in sort of what is it that we can do. worked with the club through that, and out of that came the documentary. That if that can change and people's lives, and if it can, you know, just give that, as Jay said, that opportunity for people to say, I'm going to think about this. I'm going to do something about it. You know, I think that's a really strong positive. That's what unions do as well as their workplace. They do it on behalf of, you know, their membership.
And I guess as well, you know, that if people get the chance to see the documentary, and it'll be it's Wednesday evening, but then I guess it'll be available to see.
Yeah, it's
various
on
other times.
It's on.
Well.
It's going to be released tomorrow morning on YouTube. So there'll be a link. Liverpool will be putting that out. I think from around 9-ish. I think is our expectation in the morning. But those who just want to sit down and watch it can sit down and watch LFC TV tomorrow night. It'll be on free at 9 o'clock for people to watch. And then obviously, you know, you'd see lots of people sharing it. We'll be sharing it as well, many more across social media. But just taking that opportunity to sit and watch it, it's a worthwhile watch. That even if you aren't experiencing it, that it's just good to know what others are going through. I think it tells that story really well.
For people who do see it and then respond, and it doesn't have to be, you know, this sort of light shines upon them, and right, now it all makes sense. But that response, which is a more likely response of, yeah, I feel a bit like that. In terms of the work that you're doing now through Spirit of Shankly, the connections that you're making, what sort of things would you then be saying to a member if they came to you and said, you know what, Joe, I did watch that documentary, like you said, and I feel a bit like that. What should I do next?
Well, Joe, to his credit, and I think the absolute credit to all the staff at LFC and the channel as well who've pulled this together, because they've done some fantastic work. You know, we've had this conversation, haven't we, Joe, about making sure people are signposted to the right place. Yeah. You know, we'll be sharing information and, you know, around just how you have that conversation with your mates, organisations you can go to. You know, we know there's the national ones, the documentary, signposts to them. And I think that's the point of this documentary, is it's to raise awareness and act as an anchor to getting people thinking about it, and then following it up with the work from the Mental Health Festival and the Mental Health Consortium within Liverpool around, here's who you can go to, here's who you can go and get advice from. And, you know, I think Liverpool are going to be putting some information out there saying to people, you know, here's where you can go next. And I think, you know, there's a fear sometimes that, well, if we get everyone thinking and talking about it, can we send them to the right place? And you know what? Who knows? This could produce thousands of people, and they might not all get the help, you know, as quick as we'd like. It could produce 2 or 3, and they will get the help as quick as we'd like. But in having this conversation, we start that process, you know, again, you know, because I don't think it is just a one thing. You usually have done it with the mental health work you do. For different people, it just triggers at a time. They'll just know, oh, no, now's the time to go to someone. And it'll signpost them to the right places, because I think this is the other thing within mental health, and even within the documentary, we don't have to be experts about this. We just need to be able to know and recognise when something isn't right. We don't need to know what that something is. We just need to send people to the right place or make sure they get the right support to figure out what that is. And it might be something really serious, and it could be something within your life is somewhat relatively innocuous, but you get that opportunity to start talking about something. Remove it from your head. You know, it's a big experience I found. Removing it from your head and putting it out there. You know, Jason McAteer talks about this as the others, isn't it? When they say it out loud, it's like this moment, when they say it out loud to someone, when they know in their mind and then they say it out loud to someone, there is almost this sense of like, oof, a release, it's out there now, it's real, but now I can begin to deal with it. And I think, you know, this is the starting point, I think, in some people's cases for doing that.
Yeah, I mean, Neil's dad makes a really powerful point when he's interviewed this, and he said, if this can help one person to draw back from any really serious harm to themselves, then he's really proud of that. That you know, there's a legacy there for what his son has been through. I think the spin for that, you know, that's absolutely right. But I think it's about, we want the rest of the fans who may not be at this moment in time suffering any ill health, but actually to be there for their mates.
Yeah.
And that's the other bit. So yeah, we could draw out an unknown number of people out of a Pandora's box that come forward. But actually we want the positive Pandora's box that says that, you know, I can do something. I can look out for my mate, because I recognise that he hasn't been to the last 2 home games. I wonder where he is. I'll just give him a call. And 99 times out of 100, we hope that we speak while I'm on my holidays. But it's having that question, that conversation, that we know that, you know, as I say, the well-being is going to match. It's a good experience, hopefully, for all of us when we get there, whichever football team you follow. For some people, though, there's a void after that. We can fill that void.
And I think that's the other thing, that for people who might go, no, this doesn't affect me, I'm sound, it might affect you in the future, but also it might be that you're the person who gets told. It might be that your mates are the ones who put their faith in you to open up about the thing. And then it's about knowing yourself then. What are you going to say in that regard? So you might think, oh, I don't need to worry about all this stuff. I'm sound. I'm not worried about anything. Hmm. It might be tomorrow morning that your mate knocks on your door and goes, I need to talk to somebody about this.
Yeah.
And I think that's the other thing that we need to bear in mind, that although you've got to consider your own mental health, you've also got to consider those around you. Because if you don't, you might find yourself in that conversation anyway.
Yeah. And it's that thing. It's making sure you're equipped to do that. If your mate came to you and his arm was bent the other way, you would say, I think you need help, you know, mate. And you wouldn't be sitting there thinking to yourself, oh, well, I don't need to worry about broken arms because I don't need to know where that nearest hospital is to send them to it because I haven't broke my arm.
Hmm.
But if your mate comes to you and had that problem, you'd be like, well, you need to go to the hospital, mate. You know, you definitely need to go and see someone because there's clearly a thing there. You'd know what to do. And lots of us, you know, until maybe recent times, wouldn't have known what to do. Wouldn't have known to just say to someone, well, just tell me first. Tell me how you're feeling, and then we'll figure out what you need to do next. None of us would know that, because we would be wondering, well, where do I send them to? Well, you know, you can Google it now. There's lots of organisations you can just call. You can call on your mate's behalf. And I think it's getting it in, that, as you say, they're normalising it to people that they say, well, if this happens, I roughly know what I'd need to do. You know, you don't need to be a trained first aider to know that if someone was bleeding, you need to try and stop the bleed. Is there a thing here where we get to a point where people just go, well, yeah, I reckon if now someone come to me, I think I could give them a good first go of helping them.
Yeah, and if people don't know what that sounds like, the Samaritans number always helps. It's 116123, I think, off the top of my head. If you want to find mental health services in your local area, go to hubofhope.co.uk and then type in your postcode or use location on your phone. That'll bring up all the mental health services in your local area, and it'll also tell you what they do and what they're about, be it Beacon, be it about Talk Liverpool, be it James's Place, a million and one different places, Paul's Place, a million and one different things. That's hubofhope.co.uk. Also, take them down to their local GP and get that conversation going with the GP, because obviously that then puts you within the NHS system as well.
And also, you know, practical, you know, you know, the thing I found a way to try and get help was I had read other people's stories. So, you know, go back to them. And I've had people after my story, you know, how do I get in touch with Compass? What's the S? Have you got it? You'll be ready to share that, find people's stories. You know, if people feel like they need to tomorrow, you know, they watch this programme, you know, tweet or DM Spirit of Shankly, tweet or DM me or Joe. We'll happily take the time, you know, to send the message. Because sometimes it's that. They don't want to ask them, mate, because they're not sure what it is. Ask someone who's been through it then. Ask them if they can just say, you know, I read your story. Can you tell me where you went? And okay, signpost you. It's a really simple thing, because the people who've been through this will be the first to say, if anyone has a problem, you know, I'll make sure I can tell you where you need to go. I'll make sure I signpost you to the right place, because you know what it's like to be in their shoes. So, you know, there's lots of people they can reach out to in ways they can reach out. And I think it's just saying to people, find the way that works for you and take that first step. Once that first step's taken, it's a hell of a lot different, but it's getting people ready to take that first step.
It might save lives, Joe. It'll certainly improve lives for a lot of people as well, which is why I guess it's something you're proud to be part of, both in terms of the documentary and the previews that you've seen of that, the work that's gone into that, but also the work through the Mental Health Festival going into World Mental Health Day.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's what I was trying to articulate earlier, really, that improvements in people's well-being to make people actually enjoy the life that they've got, which is only once. Is really important, and I think there's very, very many different ways that they can do that. The festivals, I think the festival's a great idea in terms of doing it. We saw it also as well earlier this year with Mental Health Pride Day. You know, in terms of the activities that go on, that kind of normalises being not normal. And I think that's what we're trying to break down, any of those stigmas, any of those barriers, quite clearly. If we can support it, you know, anything that says that improves the well-being of an individual or groups of people, then yeah, I'm immensely proud that Spirit of Shankly being involved in that. And if we've gone some way to do that, then, you know, I'm really pleased, and sure the rest of the committee members will be too.
Joe, Jay, thank you for your time. Thank you both for joining us on the programme. So the documentary that LFC TV have been working on, it's Phil Reid.
Phil Reid and others, Mark Platt and stuff like that, really good stuff. Yeah,
That's going to be Paul, sorry, that's right across social media. You've got to get everybody's name in right across
Peter and Paul. I've mistaken them there, the Paul lads.
Social media, both tomorrow morning and through the course of the day as well. LFC TV. That's tomorrow night as well, and I'm sure there'll be plenty of repeats of it as well. Thank you both for your time. Really appreciate your time on that one as well. I spoke actually with Claire Stevens from the Liverpool Mental Health Consortium and the person behind the festival as well. That's going to be included in our Mental Health Extra programming as well and podcast as well. We've got loads of mental health stuff to do this week, with it being World Mental Health Day coming up tomorrow, Wednesday, and we'll have more details on the way very soon here on Radio City Talk.